that fucking sucks, man. Like, this is Milkweg. You know, that's like the, it's the name.
Is that a phoner?
Of this place, Milkweg. It sucks that they don't even get to share in that kind of cool, like, the Milky Way. That's a cool name. Milkweg?
Is that what that means?
Milky Way, yeah. Milkweg's a gay name.
It is.
Milky Way, that's, like, cool. You know what I mean? It's like a candy bar and shit. Oh, fucking candy bars, fucking Milkwegs.
Candy bars equal cool.
Huh?
Candy bars equal cool.
Like a Snickers, that's cool. But it wouldn't be as cool if it was called a Snachun, you know? Wouldn't be fucking cool at all, I don't think. Do you think a Snacko would be as fucking cool as Snickers? Fuck no. Fuck that shit. Milkweg? Bullshit. Milky Way? Badass. Today's a fucking dark day in the DB world, in the doobie world, because our friend here, Derek Berry, young Derek, American, Derek Berry, came home from drinking last night, came back to his hotel room, fucking called his ex-girlfriend and cussed at her for how long? An hour?
111 minutes.
For 111 minutes. 111 minutes. Costing $555 to yell at his ex girlfriend. John, back on me. Thank you. Who got the last word? The ex girlfriend.
No.
I told him, I said, fucking could have spent that $555 and, like, you know, trying to hook up a piece of tail in the States, like, had it ready to pick him up at the airport when he got back, you know, or something, but no. She gonna come pick you up at the airport? You get on top of the bus and you do a fucking flip into this, I will give you 100 euro.
Writing is that reflecting sort of process where you're, like, really looking at and, you know, scrying into it, so to speak. You know, you're really letting it speak to you, and you have to build a relationship to parts, especially, you know, things that are more complicated. It takes time. It has to teach your limbs. You know?
Yeah.
It has to become part of your muscle memory. Definitely.
How deep do you think it is?
Yeah, I almost...
Seven?
There's a nature of this record that, you know, is speaking about things that are personal. I wouldn't so much say that it's about a personal experience. We've never... You know, I think one of the things that we've kind of made a focus with our records and our lyrically, too, like, what song, you know, where songs come from, is to not make them too personal for us, but to leave them open enough that as a listener, as an audience, you can build a relationship to it. If we were singing a song specifically about this bottle of water, well, that kind of, you know, everybody else can't experience this bottle of water.
Yeah.
But if we're talking about bottles of water, everybody has their own bottle of water.
Yeah.
So that you can have a personal experience with. So we try not to really sing about specific things.
Personal things.
Yeah, but no. But leave it open enough that you can build that relationship. A listener can, you know, really connect with, say, you know, if you've been through some loss or, you know, a death in your family, whatever it might be, you might be able to look into a song that maybe we weren't specifically ever saying that, but it reaches out to you and allows you to have that, connect with that experience in yourself. The songs become your own. The whole experience becomes yours. And that's something, I think that's something that we've really tried to incorporate in our songwriting process. I think it's one of the things that a lot of our fans really like about us is that ability to make the music their own.
Cool.
Well, 2PD involved with the various aspects of the way that we write our songs. Chad and I do a lot of reflecting together, just talking, conversating. He bounces a lot of ideas off of me, bounces ideas off of all of us. I think, you know, for us, it's been a very democratic experience the way we write. From even just I've got drum patterns that Chad would have written in a sense where he came up with a vocal rhythm, and once I heard his vocal rhythm, I changed
something.
I changed parts that maybe I had already written. You know, I rewrote that part to go along with that. I mean, in that sense, who wrote the drum parts?
Who's going to swim?
He was going to do it.
I'm thinking about jumping off the bus.
Yeah. Okay, but what can we expect from tonight? Because you're going to play here in Amsterdam.
Hopefully, I'll be awake by then.
Well, you're pretty awake now.
Yeah, I'm fine.
Yeah.
Yeah, you know, I think what's kind of weird about this tour right now, what's will be excited about a show like tonight. We just did Rock and Ring, Rock and Park. So we're doing these huge festivals. Yeah. And back to back with, you know, this is maybe what, like a 500, 800 seater or something like that. So we're going just from one extreme.
You're playing the big hall, start at thousands.
I'm not sure which room we're in. Yeah. But yeah, it's really weird to go from these extreme crowds of, like, you know, where you're looking at 55,000 people and the closest listener
is like 20 meters.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. It's that far away. And then, you know, here it's fans going to be right there.
Do you like that? Do you prefer that?
I don't have a preference.
Okay.
I mean, they're different flavors, and everything's got its own, you know, it has pluses and minuses. Obviously for us in Europe, playing the festivals is a great thing because it gives us a chance to play to all these fans who would never hear us. You know, people that maybe came out to see Prodigy are forced to listen to Mudvayne. Yeah. You know, maybe 1% of them, just one of them that would have never heard us, you know, might hear us and go, wow, I dig that.
Check it out, yeah.
Exactly. That's the way it goes. Which is great thing for a baby band like us in Europe, you know, trying to get a foothold.
Cool. I wish you all the best.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Cool.
He was going to, but
I'm
not
I'm going
now.
To.
No?
Yeah.
No, he's not.
I want him to.
Guilty.